loud at the end. Sorry, this is so loud. I would like to invite you Wednesday night to join us for watching Courtroom Case for Christ. It is the story of reporter Lee Strobel's investigation into the claims of Jesus Christ and what was the full movie. And I have good news for you. That is that the fact that... I think we're going to turn the light down in a second. There you go. I think that the fact that the trailer was a little hard to see at times, that's not a problem. But I just want to invite you to come be a part of that. Lee Strobel spent a lengthy amount of research, and as he did his research, of course, he became a Christian. And so the story is about his search for Christ and his finding faith in Christ. So come and join us at 6 o'clock on Wednesday night. You can see the full movie. A couple of other quick announcements before we begin. As you know, we will be starting very soon our next Discipleship Skills Workshop, Big Picture Bible. And we need to start getting a head count. We need to know things for economic seating. We need to understand things for like making photocopies. So you will find on the table where you got your bulletin and where you can get the marked red lyrics, you'll find a sign-up sheet. And the sign-up sheet will allow you to let us know that you are coming. So let us, by all means, start to fill that out so we can start to get a head count. Also, you may recall one of your tasks is going to be to memorize the books of the Bible. And so Pastor Ed got us little bookmarks with all the names of the books of the Bible. And there's a stack of them on the table back there. So feel free to take one. And it might be a clever way to help you memorize those. So please, if you can, sign in today. And as you know, as soon as we are done with worship today, we're heading over to Ross Park. It looks like the weather is breaking. We should have partly sunny skies by midday, early afternoon. We'll see you all there. As always, take time to read all of the bulletin for matters of interest to you, but let's begin our time of worship. And I will call you to worship with words from Psalm 106. Praise the Lord. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his loving kindness is everlasting. Who can speak of the mighty deeds of the or can show forth all his praise? How blessed are those who keep justice, who practice righteousness at all times. Remember me, O Lord, in thy favor toward thy people. Visit me with thy salvation, that I may see the prosperity of thy chosen ones, that I may rejoice in the gladness of thy nation, that I may glory with thine inheritance. Let's stand together and sing, Redeemed.
By the blood of the Lamb.
Let's pray together this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, it is indeed good to be in your house, to come and speak of your greatness. Just as the psalmist said, we have come here to proclaim you, to lift you up, to make you our focus, to declare that you are our God, that we serve you, that we bow the knee only to you, that you and you alone are deserving of our praise, you and you alone are deserving of our worship. And so it is good to come together, to unite our voices, and to declare that you are God, you are the great I am, and we are indeed a blessed people because you are our God. So we begin this time of prayer with prayers of thanksgiving, prayers of adoration, prayers of exaltation, where we declare our love for you and we declare our devotion. So Lord, receive these prayers of thanksgiving, receive these prayers of exaltation. And it is our desire that they be a sweet aroma to you in heaven. Lord, we also come humbly to confess our sins. Forgive us when our hearts wander. Forgive us when we chase after the pleasures offered by this world. Forgive us when our love for the world is greater than our love for you. And so we come this morning to confess those sins and ask you to forgive us. We do not do so presumptuously. We do not do so vain way, but we do so according to the atoning death of Jesus Christ, who died once for all, who died a death that soothed your righteous anger. And whereas we were once the targets of your wrath, because we are in Christ, and we have been forgiven, have been made new, we are now the targets of your love. So we come like loving children. Say to you, our Heavenly Father, that we have sinned. Forgive us, O Lord. Cleanse us through the blood of Jesus. And keep us from temptation. Lord, we also want to come this morning and pray for the lost. I think it's probably fair to say that each one of us have family members, friends, loved ones that we pray for often, that you will open their eyes, that you will pull back the blinders, that you will allow the blind to see, that you will give them ears to hear, that they might hear your voice and be your sheep and come to your side. And so we want to pause this morning and cry out to you on behalf of those who are lost and ask you to be merciful to them and to save them and to make them yours. Lord, we also want to pray for those who are sick, those who are hurting physically, those who are facing financial challenges. Lord, we want to pray for the continued recovery of Mona Chaffee and Gail Cummings as they are recovering from different ailments. Mona, a kidney issue. Gail, her heart. Lord, we want to pray for our friend Dean Fritzmeyer, who has begun a new regimen of medications for his long-haul COVID symptoms as we enter into the 10th month of that battle. We pray that you will be merciful and kind, and that these will be a help to him, and strengthen him and return him to full health. Lord, we pray for our friend Janet Powers, who is recovering from a broken wrist and is now having tests to see if she has had some strokes. And so we pray for her that they will know how to help prevent that in the future. We pray for Jim Burns. They're talking about bringing in hospice care for her and many others that we know of, friends, family members, neighbors, who stand in need of your encouragement. So we offer up these to you this morning and pray that your will be done in their lives. Now, Lord, as we continue in our time of praise and worship and study, grant to us a sincere heart. Give us a sincere motivation as we sing, as we study, as we pray. Lord, help us to do so in a way that is pleasing in your sight, so that all that we do and say will bring glory and honor to you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let's stand together as we do continue in song. Dale comes and leads us in our next hymn, At Calvary.
summer, we have been enjoying reading the Old Testament characters, picking up character traits. Some of these character traits are poor character traits, which we want to avoid. And many have been positive traits, which hopefully have inspired you to implement those into your very lives. Today, we're going to be looking at the book of Ruth. So if you'd like to turn your Bibles to the book of Ruth. For those who haven't memorized their Bible yet, just beyond the Pentateuch, you go to Joshua, Judges, Ruth. Or third book beyond Deuteronomy. Ruth is a very beloved book, so we can't cover the whole thing in one message. And we're just going to extract some of the stories and try to pull out character traits. But I would like to remind you, in the book of Ruth, there are three main characters in this story. Naomi, Boaz, and Ruth. You know, the book is basically about how God miraculously delivers Naomi's family. In the first five verses, we'll look at more carefully later, but we'll learn that Naomi's life falls apart. She becomes a widow, and her sons also die, which means that this family line is in danger of going out of existence. However, in the last chapter of the book, that the family line will continue because of a kinsman redeemer named Boaz who married the widow Ruth, and they produce a baby boy whose name is Obed. So the family will be saved. Peek over to chapter 4 for a minute if you have your Bibles open. So let me read Ruth chapter 4, verses 13 and 14. So Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. And when he went into her, the Lord gave her conception, and she bore a son. Now, this is good news for Ruth and Boaz, right? They're having a baby boy. This is exciting. Look at verse 14. Then the women say to Naomi, put the brakes on. Naomi, what happened to Boaz? Blessed be the Lord who has not left you this day without a close relative, and may his name be famous in Israel. So it's interesting that the story is about fulfilling the need of Naomi. So the whole story here in the book of Ruth is about Naomi, but the book is not named the book of Naomi, is it? Well, how about Boaz? Boaz was the Jewish male hero of the book. Right? He's the one who takes Ruth for a wife, and they have a baby boy, which fulfills the big need of the story. Boaz becomes a type of Christ as the kinsman redeemer. Oh, another whole sermon we're not going to talk about today. Yet, this book is not named the book of Boaz, is it? The book is called Ruth. This is interesting. This is the only non-Jewish person in the Old Testament that a book is named after. And not only is it a non-Jewish person, it's also in Old Testament times. So, what is it about Ruth? I hope that gets your interest. Further, let me mention some more details here. Of the three main characters we just talked about, Ruth has the least amount of spoken lines in the book. Boaz and Naomi speak more. Yet the book is named about Ruth. That's probably because of her character. That's what I'm going to talk about today. One of the main reasons the name Ruth is because she was a person of outstanding character. And the part of her character today I want to extract and look at, her life stood out because of the decisions she made and the ability to follow through with these decisions, good decisions, even when things got tough. That is a character trait that's missing today. Let me mention something else about Ruth over here. In chapter 3, if you're there, verses 10 and 11, she's called a virtuous woman. And this comes from Boaz as he's giving her a compliment, saying yes to the marriage invitation. Then he said, blessed are you of the Lord, my daughter, for you have shown more kindness at the end than at the beginning, in that you did not go after young men when you reached before. And now, my daughter, do not fear, for I will do all that you have requested. Listen to this. For all the people of my town know that you are a virtuous woman. We're going to have to figure out why they know. But what does virtuous mean? You know, I want to say this is a little deceptive in English. We also have this as the virtuous woman of Proverbs 31. The Hebrew word translated here usually means strength or being rich, for example, especially when applied to an army or to a man. Look at Ruth chapter 2, verse 1. It says, there was a relative of Naomi's husband, a man of great wealth. That word there, wealth, is the same word as virtuous. So quite often it's applied as great strength or great riches. It was also used a lot of one having great valor or braveness, or of one who's capable. And that's, those last two are the ones I'm going to grab a hold of. The virtuous woman is a woman of valor, but also a capable woman. So it's not calling for one to be virtuous in the sense that we're thinking of in behavior in that word. However, I would argue that outstanding character traits would be prerequisite. One could not be considered capable if using sinful means. So what the text is communicating is that Ruth was not only a godly woman, but she was also a capable woman who could do what was right and good when many others would fail. You know, doing what is right is hard at times. And doing what is wrong or evil seems to be so easy at times. This is why she's a virtuous woman, because she is capable of doing what is right, even during those most difficult times. With that being said, let's get right into the story. Let's move back to Ruth chapter 1, verses 1 through 5, and get the setting for the book. Ruth chapter 1, verse 1. Now it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land. And a certain man of Bethlehem, Bethlehem Judah, went to dwell in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife was Naomi, and the names of his two sons were Melon and Chilion, Ephrathites of Bethlehem Judah. And they went to the hill country of Moab and remained there. Then Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left with her two sons. Now they took wives of the women of Moab, and the name of one was Orpah, and the name of the other was Ruth. And they dwelt there about 10 years. Then Mahlon and Chilion also died. So the woman survived her two sons and her husband. So I want to talk about a few things here, just to get us set up. First of all, this was in the days of the judges, which says a lot. I developed this a little bit when I talked about Samuel. Let's do it again. One of the phrases that's recurring in the book of Judges is, in those days there was no king in Israel, so everyone did what was right in his own eyes. Since there was no authoritative figure, people would justify what they believed was best. Of course, we would expect this from ungodly people, but this is also true of godly or religious people as well. Let me mention a few character traits here. First is the idea of autonomy. This is not a newly American thing, but we love the idea of freedom of choice. We love the idea of picking and choosing what we think is best for us. However, this is not always good, I would suggest, for those who follow Christ, right? Are we supposed to deny ourselves and follow Christ? And that's because he knows what is best, and he knows what God's plan is, and he's heading us in a direction. So let's think about how our modern-day churches pick this up today. I think a good word might be, again, syncretism. Use syncretism. That's when you go in and you pick what parts of religious life that you think are important and you want to participate in, and you minimize the other things. This can lead to some sort of consumer-based church, which we see all over the place today. Depends on what you want in a church. Oh, that was a good service, good programs. Oh, don't don't they have the greatest worship?
Makes you feel good.
Or that person can really preach. Don't you love having a great preacher up front? I mean, if you need that, you can get the best of the best on TV or on the internet, right? But people come to church and they get their peace that they want. Kind of like leaving a restaurant. They leave their tip in the plate and they go home, having no real connection with the life of the church. Then we are free to live our autonomous life with a synchronistic approach to Christianity. So we too have a similar culture to this time of the Judges. But let me give you a few examples from the time of Judges here. Again, a couple weeks ago I talked about the life of Samuel. If you remember in that story, the one godly man at the beginning was Elkanah, and two wives. One was Hannah. But we never talked much about marrying two wives, did we? He was pictured as an upright religious man in the book. He went to Shiloh every year, sacrificed. So how did he decide to have two wives? More than likely it happened because Hannah was barren. And the appropriate cultural response was to have another wife because the desire to have a male son or male heir was so strong. And this was true of many men in the Old Testament, right? When Abraham and Sarah could not have a child, they agreed to take on Hagar as a second wife and have a child. This was a mix of culture and religion. They may not have even been aware that they had drifted into immorality. This then is an example of can easily be passed down to the next generation when your godly relatives did it this way as a culture that was passed down. But I would suggest that that's not completely true of the Old Testament. Remember Isaac and Rebekah, and they too were barren. Remember what Isaac did? Let me read this to you, Genesis 25:21. Now Isaac pleaded with the Lord for his wife because she was barren, and the Lord granted his plea, and Rebekah, his wife, conceived. So instead of taking the cultural route of grabbing a second wife, he got on his knees and prayed. And the Lord God did help. Why did this tradition not go forward? Again, because doing what is right is hard, and doing what is wrong can be easy, especially when it's culturally acceptable. So again, we too live in an ungodly culture where everyone loves to keep up with their own lives. Our culture too highly values personal autonomy. Even in the religious world, we like to think that we should have no other authority over us than God. And then that gets us into trouble because we can't all know what God really wants. We're not all on top of God's will. God helps others. So then we tend to think what we want and we justify it as if God would want what we want. So there's all kinds of trouble with this autonomy, synchronistic approach that we have. And they had the same thing here in the book of Ruth. And that led to a bad decision. Back to our story. Elimelech takes his wife, Naomi, and two sons. He was blessed with two sons already. And he moves to Moab to get away from the famine in the land of Moab. The problem here was that famine was a plague, which the Lord usually put on the people as a judgment from God, right? It was to help them see their need of God, which would cause them to repent, get their lifestyles in order, and come back to Him and approach Him for help. The Israelites did this often in the book of Judges, and God would then raise up a judge to deliver them. However, Elimelech took a different path. He attempted to move his family and make a living in Moab. Perhaps the plague was not as significant in the land of freedom to do his work. I doubt that he put any religious significance into this move. I suspect it was very practical and logical. My wife and family need to eat, so I need to move where I can make a living. However, we should mention that this also would mean that Elimelech was leaving the promised land, the land that God had promised to the Jews, the land where the people were to meet with God. A move to Moab would seem to be a move away from the promises of God. And then we have it. While in Moab, Elimelech dies. This, of course, was one of the worst things that could have ever happened to Naomi. Now her her protector, her provider. Her love was gone. And she became a very vulnerable widow in a culture that had little room for girls. But she was fortunate in that yet she had two adult sons who could take care of her, kind of plan B, a safety valve, if you will. However, as we read here in the text, these two sons also showed a lack of judgment and made bad decisions, just like their father and mother. They married two Moabite women. Again, this was a very logical and understandable decision. These were young men who needed wives. They now made their home in Moab. There's no Jewish women in Moab. There's Moab women in abundance. So once again, we can see how important decision-making can be. I would say that the wisdom of God that he gives to us is often not convenient. It was not convenient for these young men to wait for Israeli women, but it was easy to set aside that and pick up Moabite women. But let's put that into our context today. I had this sermon done a week ago, and I know this is the same one Pastor marry a non-believer, or should even a religious couple or non-religious couple cohabit before marriage? I mean, you could make arguments like, these are just regular people. Why shouldn't I marry this person? It's a very good person. Good job, good personality. You make a great spouse. You have all these good logical arguments. I remember one time I did a wedding here, and afterwards, a friend of the groom was down here. And his girlfriend and him are sitting very close. And you can tell that they were connected. And I asked, I said, oh, you guys might be next getting married. He goes, oh, no, we're going to live together for a while first. Right in church, talking right to me. So I questioned this young man a little bit. You know, his mom did. He says, oh, no, this is my mom and dad advice. This is my grandma. And I thought, oh, good night. Can you see the cultural influence all the way through? It just made sense to follow that culture. I would say in both of these situations, wouldn't it make sense that if God is actually the creator and designer of all things, then he ought to know what is best for us? Would it not seem right and good to do what he says? Should we not follow the instruction manual that God has made for us? Thus, it would be best, good or right, to make the heart perhaps this illustration is way too easy this morning. Nevertheless, the cultural pull to do our own thing is so strong that we all at times will be tempted to do such things. It can get even harder when there's no direct Bible verse to cover the topic in question. That's when we need to be discerning and go out into our larger Christian worldview and be able to put principles together and to make decisions. Sometimes we need help from others. There's a lot of things to this idea of decision making. Well, back to our story. In our first few verses here of the setting, we had the final piece here, where finally we read that both of Naomi's sons die. Now there are three widows in the family, no men, no children. It seems like the ultimate disaster has hit. Again, being a widow in ancient times was a very hard and dangerous place. No income to live on. No men to provide the need of security. There's no police to protect you as well. What would these three women do? In the following conversation, we will be able to discern the various worldviews from these women as we read their solutions in verses 6 through 14. So let's read that. Then Naomi arose with her daughters-in-law that she might return from the country of Moab, for she had heard in the country of Moab that the Lord had visited her people by giving them bread. Therefore, she went out from the place where she was, and her two daughter-in-laws with her, and they went on their way to return to the land of Judah. And Naomi said to her two daughter-in-laws, go, return each to your mother's house. The Lord deal kindly with you, as you have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant that you may find rest each in the house of her husband. So she kissed them, and they lifted up their voices and wept. And they said to her, "Surely we will return with you." But Naomi said, "Turn back, my daughters. Why will you go with me? Are there still sons in my womb that they may be your husbands? Turn back, my daughters, go, for I am too old to have a husband. If I should say I have hope, if I have a husband tonight and I should bear sons, would you wait until they were grown old? Would you restrain yourself from having husbands? No, my daughters, for it grieves me very much for your sakes that the hand of the Lord has gone out against me." Then they lifted up their voices and wept, and Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to her. So let's make a few observations here. While in Moab, Naomi hears that Israel was once again prospering. Even in her grief, she knows logically that she would be better off in Israel as a widow. Israel had many laws in place to help the needy. Other countries did not have such policies. Plus, Naomi would always be an outsider as long as she lived in Moab, which means she would get less care. And we can also see Naomi's logical thinking when she advises her daughter-in-laws. Again, this makes perfect sense to us even today. Go home, find new husbands, start your lives over. Don't waste your life. You'll live a life of poverty by coming to me. Orpah was convinced by her advice and her logic. And we have to admit it makes sense to us, doesn't it? So she said her goodbyes, kissed her goodbye, and went home. And probably started over. We never hear from her again, but maybe she did find a husband and have a normal life. Ruth, however, had a very different response. I like her response. Let's take a peek. Verses 16 and 17. But Ruth said, "Entreat me not to leave you or to turn back from following after you. For wherever you go, I will go. For where you go, I will go. Your people shall be my people, and your God my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. The Lord do so to me, and more also, if anything but death parts." I like how she starts out here. "Stop urging me to leave. It's not going well." Of course, there's some wonderful promises there we pick up. I can't develop them all today. Wherever you go, I am going. Your people shall be my people. Your God shall be my God. Where you die and are buried. But let's look at a couple of key points here that I want to pull out here. Ruth was not going with her mother-in-law because Ruth needed the help. She doesn't. She's going because Naomi needs the help. We need to get the hold of that, first of all. This was a very hard decision. Let's put that up front. This was not an easy decision. It went against all cultural common sense. Ruth was placing the life and well-being of Naomi above her own needs. I suspect that she knew that her youth would be a huge help to the aging Naomi. Perhaps they could survive together. Orpah made the more culturally wise decision, right? She was still young enough to get married. And let's make it clear, they were young. Most girls got married in their mid-teens, 13 to 15 years old. So if she's 15, married 10 years, she's still 25. She's still of marrying age and childbearing age. So she made a culturally wise decision to go home. Do we have any New Testament scriptures that might remind you of Ruth's decision? Oh, there's tons of them, but one popped into my mind, and that's Philippians 2. Let me read that to you. "Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. Let each of you look out not only for your own interest, but also for interests of others." So let me contextualize this a little bit today. Scenario is very relevant, I think. In the book of Ruth, Orpah is being taught to look out for number one. And I think we too are taught to look out for number one. How is God going to? going to provide for you. Maybe you've heard that. God wants the best you, right?
Very culturally.
But let me put the burden back on us. What lengths would you go to take care of your aging relatives? In our culture, we seemingly have an out, right? Because our government would step in and supply some basic relief. But I might say that this can become an excuse so that we do not even consider the harder issues and how we might care for our elders. Perhaps now we can begin to understand the weight of her decision that Ruth was making. I suspect that many would have mocked Ruth at that time, Moab, saying she's throwing her life away. She's going to die obscure in poverty, starving over in Israel. Ruth's decision to do what was right was hard. Also, she was all in. She said, stop urging me. I like that. Stop urging me. And it's not going to happen. You know, Ruth had lived with her husband for 10 years, and I'm not sure what instructions she received from the family, but she chose to leave everything behind and to follow Naomi back to the Promised Land. It's no small thing to leave your family and your country. When she arrives in Israel, everyone will know that she is different. She's all righteous. And she may face persecution for being different. She was giving up her basic safety and security. Support systems. Also, it is huge to leave behind her old religious beliefs to become a follower of the true and living God. Again, I assume that her husband introduced her to God during the 10 years that they were married. And her decision to go now just reinforced that Ruth wasn't actually a true believer. But her leaving behind the old and going forward reminds me of the testimony that Paul talks about to the Thessalonians when he describes them. Listen to this in 1 Thessalonians 1:9. Paul says, for they themselves declaring concerning us what manner of entry we had to you and how you turned to God from idols to serve. That's exactly what happened. Ruth turned from the gods of Moab. Ruth's heart must have been changed, and perhaps that's why we can see the difference between her response and Orpah's response. So this first decision by Ruth was tough. This was a tough decision, and as we'll see, she continues to follow through with it. I have some time here, so I want to develop some more. I make a little less reading, a little more talking. But in chapter 2, Ruth decides to go back, when she's in the land, to go back to work. You know, Naomi and Ruth would have been dependent upon handouts when they went back to Israel to survive. But Ruth desired not to sit and be idle. She desired to work. She was capable. She was not scared to go out and work. She had valor. She was brave. It can be dangerous for any foreigner to go work, especially a young, available. So she asked her mother-in-law for advice. This was wise. And Naomi gives her the basics of the tradition and how gleaning worked in her country. In Israel, the landowners had to leave portions of the crop behind for people in need. This is kind of a welfare system, but a working welfare system. There's food for you. You just need to go get it. And so it's interesting that they actually had to work for their food a little bit. There it was. I would add that this was another important decision made by Ruth. Everyone in that small town would have been watching her. And they were already impressed that she would leave her country to come and take care of Naomi. And now she takes it a step further. She is going out into the fields to work. We may not understand that completely. I mean, we live in air-conditioned homes. We drive in cars. I go to my air-conditioned workplace. When she went out here, she's going to work in long, hot hours in the sun to gather food supplies for the two of them. Now, the story here moves along pretty quickly in her book. I would suggest to you that she was out there weeks and months working. And I think this hard work, we can start to see who Ruth really was. She was a hard-working good-looking, capable woman, and everyone knew it. So once again, going to work made a good decision. Listen to the words of the Apostle Paul to the Thessalonians. He says, "For even when we were with you, we commanded you this. If anyone will not work, neither shall he eat. For we hear that there are some who walk among you in disorderly manner, not working at all, but are busybodies. Now those who are such, we command and exhort through our Lord Jesus Christ that they work with quietness and eat their own bread." Everyone knows that work is important. Also, everyone knows when people are lazy, taking advantage of it. Ruth's decision to work hard and to earn a living was impressive, and she followed through with it. So again, I want to say that Ruth is proving to be a very industrious, capable woman who makes good decisions, obeys the commands of God. And one final decision we want to talk about today, and that's the third decision, to get married. So look at chapter 3 with me if you would. We'll read a few verses here. This is a little more exciting part of the story. Nobody wants to hear about work, right? Chapter 3, verses 1 to 4. Then Naomi, her mother-in-law, said to her, "My daughter, shall I not seek security or rest, actually, for you, that it may be well with you? Now Boaz, whose young woman you were with, is he not our relative? In fact, he is winnowing barley tonight at the threshing floor. Therefore, wash yourself and anoint yourself and put on your best." Wow, interesting. Dressed up and go down to the threshing floor, and do not make yourself known to the man until he's finished eating and drinking. Then it shall be when he lies down that you shall notice the place where he lies, and you shall go in, uncover his feet, and lie down, and he will tell you what to do next. All right, let's think about this a little bit. Naomi knew the laws and traditions of Israel much better. Naomi's suggestion is that Ruth make herself available to Boaz to get married. Now, this is more than mere matchmaking, right? Naomi still had some rights over some portion of land, but these rights needed to be redeemed by the current people who controlled it. If Ruth married the right man, then the homestead could be saved. And if she had a baby boy, then the family lineage could continue. Of course, we'll see this as a catch. This redeemer needs to be a kinsman of Elimelech, her husband. Now, this all sounds pretty good in theory, but let's bring it down a little bit more practical. Ruth was about 25 years old. She still had many years to live. Boaz was a relative of Elimelech, who would have been older than Naomi. So he's easily in his 50s. Easily. Maybe more. So, you're asking a 25-year-old woman to go marry a guy in his 50s, maybe 60 years old. So I want to say this would not be a marriage for love or because the guy was good-looking and strong. And she probably didn't know as much about Boaz as you would normally have in some sort of relationship. Boaz was the boss, and you weren't too close to the boss, right? The main reason for this call to marriage was to save the family line and to have a place for Ruth ultimately to land as well. But this is still a big ask by anybody. And we get a real simple from Ruth: I'll do it. She made a decision. Another very difficult decision. Again, this is the right decision for this particular. Also note at this point, not only it may have been undesirable for her, I don't know, but it's also risky. What if Boaz said, "You know, I'm not interested. Thanks." I mean, it wasn't automatic. Again, Ruth is not only showing that she was a capable woman, she's very brave. Think about this. She had to go out at night in stealth and watch him eat and drink and then go to bed. She had to spy on Boaz. Wait for the poor old guy to go to bed. Then she had to be brave and approach Boaz and go through with instructions Naomi took. Again, it's all on paper, it looks easy, but when you're there, you're actually sneaking in, you got to do these things. It is hard. It takes some gumption. She did it. She followed through with instructions of the God. But what was she really asking for? There's all kinds of weird stuff, so I'm going to stop here just for a moment and give you some ideas. Without explaining too deep, in Hebrew narrative, people learn through listening. And in while they're listening, the authors will put what we call hook words in from the narrative. And they would catch these hook words, and that brought meaning to passages. Look back to chapter 2 and verse 12. This is while Boaz is giving a compliment to Ruth. The Lord repay you for your work, and a full reward be given to you by the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings you have come for refuge. Get the wings part here. This is a picture of God as the one who will take care of her. Look at Ruth's ask in chapter 3 and verse 9. And he said, "Who are you?" So she answered, "I am Ruth, your maidservant. Take your maidservant under your wing." Did you get that? "For I am a close relative." She was asking for Boaz to be the hands and feet of God and to bring that blessing and the protection of God over her. If God's going to bring it, Boaz promised it. Now she's saying, "Boaz, will you be my person?" That's what she was asking for. If I was preaching, I'd get off on another concept. It was worth noting. That's Boaz. He's a quite It's worth noting that we can be the ones who God uses to bless others. So let me say that. But let's come back to our story and see what happens. So what happens next in verses 3? Chapter 3, verses 10 and 11. 10 through 12. Then Boaz said, "Blessed are you of the Lord, my daughter, for you have shown more kindness at the end than you have at the beginning, and that you did not go after young men or for the riches of your work. And now, my daughter, do not for all the people of my town know that you are a virtuous woman. Now it is true that I am a close relative. However, there is a relative close by the way." Boaz gladly accepted the invitation. However, there's one more wrinkle to rule get through here. There was one kinsman who was closer. And Boaz pretty carefully threads that needle in chapter 4. He's talking to the guy, the other guy. Let's read that. I'll take some time this morning. Chapter 4, verses 1 to 6. "Now Boaz went up to the gate and sat down there, and behold, the close relative of whom Boaz had spoken came by. So Boaz said, 'Come aside, friend, sit down.' So he came aside, and he took 10 men of the elders of the city and said, 'Sit here.'" You know it's a little bit of a trap, right? You say, "Hey, let's have a cup of coffee. Hey, you 10, come over here." You know something's going to happen, right? "Then he said to the close relative of Naomi, who's come back from the country of Moab, 'Sold a piece of land which belonged to our brother Elimelech. And I thought to inform you, saying, buy it back in the presence of the inhabitants of the elders of my people. If you will redeem it. But if you will not redeem it, tell me that I may know, for there's no other but you to redeem it. And I am next after you.' He said, 'Oh, redeem it.' And Boaz said, 'Oh, by the way, there is another line in very defined details here. On the day you buy it from the hand of Naomi, you must also buy it from Ruth of Moabitess, the wife of the dead, to perpetuate the name of the dead through his inheritance.'" Also, the close relative says, "Oh, well, hang on. I cannot redeem it. I ruin my own inheritance. You redeemed the right of redemption yourself, for I can't." The one here, that word ruin is interesting. It's probably better translated here, polluted. "I will pollute my inheritance." He was concerned with having a Moabite in his lineage. That was a big deal at that time. Today it's not a big deal, but that was a big deal. So story comes back that Boaz and Ruth do get married, and they have a son whose name is Obed. Thus, the problem of the family lineage was solved. But God had even greater plans than this. Obed was the great-grandfather of David, who would become king of Israel. This is probably the main reason why this book makes it into the canon of the Old Testament law, right? There's probably a lot of great stories in the Old Testament, but this one connects to King David, which makes it so valuable for the people of Israel to read and to understand. However, beyond that, what the Old Testament saints did not know, we now know that David's line continues through Jesus, who would be the Messiah. So this answer was even greater than that what the Old Testament people thought when they were putting it in the canon. This makes me think of the words of the Apostle Paul in the book of Ephesians. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to the power that is at work within us. The good decisions of Ruth not only solved Naomi's problem, they not only were blessed to become part of the royal Davidic line, they ultimately became part of the lineage of Jesus Christ. So the decisions that we make and our follow-through can really be used by God. Let me state that a different way, a principle for you to think about today. God uses ordinary people who are faithful to live right, to do great things for his glory. He's not looking for great people. He has plenty of those if he wants them. He's looking for ordinary people, you and me, to be faithful and to make those hard decisions and do what is right, represent him well to his glory. So in conclusion today, let's talk about decisions just for a minute. We all have to make decisions. No one here today is not making decisions. Many seem small. Do I need to go to work today, or should I just quit? No, I guess that's choosing our clothes for the day. What food we're going to eat. Even Paul grabs a hold of that, right? 1 Corinthians 10:31, that we're to do all our drink. Even the small decisions are important. Of course, we have big decisions. Going to marry, something like that. And the big decisions, we get it, but small ones sometimes slide through. The point I want us to grab a hold of today is that our decisions have consequences. And that they are very important. Further, if we follow through with these decisions, that's what makes us a person of character. I think we often know what is right and wrong. And following through with the right is the hard part. That's where the character comes in. And Ruth proved to be a person who could follow through with very difficult decisions. So just let me, in closing here, give you three thoughts about decision making. There's a lot, but let me give you a basic three to start with. Are our decisions biblical in thought? Our decisions, are they biblical in thought? Have we denied ourselves and attempted to follow Christ? Are we willing to follow through? Let me say those three again. Think about our decisions. Are they biblical in thought? Have we denied ourselves and attempted to follow Christ? Are we willing to follow through no matter what the cost? Not this Wednesday, but two Wednesdays ago, we watched a movie. We watched the life story of William Tyndale. Probably one of my favorite stories. I love that story. Not because I like all the translations. He is a man who took translated the Bible into English, which we still use much of today. But his decisions to follow Christ and to translate the Bible got him killed. But he was willing to follow through with it. And his work, even after his death, was so influential that we are still affected today. Are we willing to go forth us consider our decisions today a little more carefully and learn to give God the glory through our life. Let's close in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the example of the book of Ruth. Oh Lord, that on paper things look easy at times, but when it comes down to our ability to live them out, things get difficult quickly. So Lord, I pray that you will quicken our minds this week. Send your Spirit, guide us. And if we need to be making a decision and we're going the wrong way, I just ask, Lord, that you step back and consider some of our basic grid about being biblical and knowing ourselves. These are important things for the Christian life. And I ask, Lord, that we will raise up and be people of character. And also, Lord, I pray, like others, that all may know that about themselves. Such a Savior.
Would you stand with me, please? Before the benediction, just a couple of quick reminders. If you can, on your way out, please let us know if you're going to participate in the Big Picture Bible class that begins on Sunday, September 12th at 5:30. A bookmark and begin memorizing the books of the Bible. Also, I think most of you may have heard that Shane and Katie Kolkowski had their baby this week, a baby girl. She is doing well. Mother is doing well. Yeah, but 45 minutes, the midwife did not make it to their house on time, so Shane delivered the baby. That's Hall of Fame stuff right there. That gets you in the Hall of Fame. Yeah, that's right. Today we'll do another radical thing on a Monday. There's still a need there. We still have a need for a few later in the week. Cindy, do they need to see you? If they can, so if you can help, please let Cindy know so she can get you on the schedule. So, and also, as soon as we get done here, we're heading out to Ross Park. The first for you to get there. Go ahead and start organizing food. Hopefully we'll get there and say a blessing 10 minutes after 12, 15 minutes after 12. It shouldn't take that long. We gather to say a blessing and we'll eat together. All right, I send you forth with these words, this great blessing from the book of Numbers. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance on you and give you peace. God bless you. Have a great day. I look forward to seeing many of you.